We've gathered here today to talk about a very important topic, which is climate change and mental health. And I'm going to delve into digital sustainability. I think that's an issue that has been there around our lives. And people who were born in 70s and 80s, we know that, you know, how the transformation has happened in around our lives. We have moved from, you know, our simple refrigerator to a smart refrigerator that we operate through our cell phones. We have become, you know, in the different world where we are slaves to a device that is of 4 inches to 6 inches. I'm talking about the cell phones. How many of you read your Facebook or LinkedIn or any other social media today? A lot of you, right? A lot of us did, and I also did, right? Because we have become slaves to it. And it has become access to information and everything, and we are in a digital age where we're trying to rat race, you know, with everybody that, you know, we should know. And right, you see the media houses as well. They delve into the information that who will be the first person to share this information with the world. We have also seen new professionals that are coming in, and I'm not saying that's bad, right? These are the influencers that are following that, you know, I need a following of, you know, 1 million, 2 million, 3 million followers, and I want to be the best. I want to be a person, you know, people follow and think about it. So, you know, I'm a techie. I've seen world when I started my career way back. I started learning basic, and I used to get opportunity on a computer for a very limited period of time. Then I moved to Java. You know, I learned Java, I learned C++ and other languages. And over the years, I've seen that, you know, technology is changing, and it's changing our lives as well. And as a technology person, I think that we can definitely do things when it comes to sustainability, because I see the impact of this, you know, on our environment in a big way. Now, when I talk about digital sustainability is a term that helps you create less impact on the environment through the technology. Now, when I come to digital sustainability, let me delve into other points that technology can help digital sustainability. Number one, I think, you know, from batteries. So how many of us carry the power banks, and we always care about the airports while traveling that, you know, we have a power bank with us. So I was in Zurich in the airport, and I was talking to an old man, and we were supposed to board our plane in the next 10 minutes, 15 minutes, probably left. And he was looking for a charger. That, hey, do you have an Apple phone charger? I said, yes, I have. Let me help you with that. So I was looking into, obviously I was curious, right? Why he was looking, I think probably he has like 10%, 15% battery. His battery was only 70%. So for a 1 hour flight, he wanted to charge it to be ensure 100%. And obviously we know all our parents that are thriving for 100% battery, and we are slaves, right? We want to ensure that this phone is 100% charged, and he doesn't need that phone on a plane. Definitely he won't connect with anybody. So that's a problem. And that is what I'm trying to address, you know, how technology can help in digital sustainability. So I think number one is adaptable, you know, batteries. Because, you know, when you talk about batteries, they're not able to compost very easily. And we have to delve into this that, you know, how we can ensure that these batteries are taken care of. So we need to look for some niche materials, you know, for battery creation. We have to look for that are recyclable, that can be managed better way. Now you see e-scooters, lot of cars like Tesla and others, right? What is this all about? And people are looking for now fast charging, you know, 65 watt, 350 watt. I want to charge my car immediately. I can't wait. I need to go now, right? Within 1 hour, within 2 hours. What is that problem? Is it sustainable enough? It's not. Why? Because to generate that power, you will be again using a generator to generate that electricity to charge your car. Or you're using 65 watt charger to charge your phone immediately. So that is an important area. Now, I think we have all come across ChatGPT. We have all come across Bard. These are all generative AI, right? That helps us giving the information immediately that, you know, this is all about, you know, giving you the information and everything. And I am a member of Forbes Technology Council, and we discuss and delve into it. I speak with different clients, you know, different Fortune 500 people. And we all delve into this requirement that Everybody wants to win it. Let's build a product. I want to build a product that helps me go through different documents immediately. That could be in legal, that could be in anything from document processing. And I'm talking about large language models, LLM. And if you see from generative AI, which is the ChatGPT, there are a lot of companies that have been founded very recently. And they have received a lot of funding, 5 million, 10 million, 15 million, 20 million. What is this happening to that generative AI models that have been building? They are taking a lot of computing power, right? Because what the reels you watch, what the things we review, everything needs a computing power. And these servers are generating a lot of heat that is not sustainable enough for our environment. So what we can do as a technologist, right? I believe my tech enthusiast, my engineers will be listening to my talk later. So I want to encourage them to focus on green coding. So what is the green coding is all about? Green coding is about creating efficient algorithms to ensure that the digital footprint gets reduced. So that's a very important thing. Now, I think there are a lot of experts in from the healthcare space, and I'm an expert in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and we are doing a lot of things. And as an active researcher, my focus is on artificial intelligence intersect with healthcare. And I'm focusing on cancer diagnosis. So if you look into cancer diagnosis, there are a lot of scans that are done. And these scans are very expensive for a normal person, right? And they need, again, humongous power, control, ACs and everything, you know, to maintain that. Is it sustainable? It's not. So I'm looking into delving into this question that, you know, how we can make that possible, that using the historical data of the scans and the patient symptoms and everything, we are able to immediately identify. And I was able to identify a lot of correlation that, you know, we can delve into this and do that in a better way. Now let's talk about agriculture. Now agriculture is another sector. You know, we talk about agriculture, and I think I live in Delhi, and I notice that every winters, there is a lot of smog that exists. And people say that it comes from Punjab. If somebody says it's come from somewhere, we need to reduce and we need to focus on odd even now. I need to ensure that my car is an odd number or an even number to drive out today, right? Why is that? It's because from the agricultural pollution. So agriculture, if you see, it's one of the industries that create pollution in a humongous way, right? Because they need to take care of the waste. And identifying, you know, to get rid of that waste is that they burn, right? So I think there can be sustainable ways, and the government is aware about it. The politicians, the policy makers, everybody is aware about it. But nobody wants to delve into that issue that how we can take care of that. And I believe the same way it can be dealt is from a heat management. If the burning is done centralized and in a sustainable way that creates energy generation, that will be an important point that will take it further. Now let's delve into other areas. So, you know, what we as a normal people, what we can do, right? So let's talk about, we talk about power nap to refresh ourselves, right? So I'm giving a concept of digital nap. What digital nap is? A digital nap is not for you. A digital nap is for your device that is in your pocket, or a digital nap is for your computer that you use for your working. You need to give them a break, right? There are a lot of people, and I know a lot of engineers, and I'm also guilty sometimes, that I don't switch off my laptop, or I don't switch off my device. I don't give them a break. I want to ensure that they're available 100% of the time. I think, my friends, we need to give them a break. Because they will work more efficiently, and that will be a more sustainable solution. Now I talk about e-scape. Now e-scape is another term that I would like to give you. Now e-scape is that we escape from nature, right? Or we escape from work. We escape from work and we travel to places where we want to holiday in Switzerland, France, Italy, and all the reels that we watch. What is that? We want to give an escape to our chargers. We don't switch off our chargers, you know, for a long time. I think that's another area where we need to give them an escape, and we need to turn off the switch to ensure that they are able to take what? Saving of the energy. The third point is digital gardening. Now, digital gardening is simple, very simple. As we take care of our plants, right? There may be a lot of naturalists who are fond of grass is green, a lot of greenery around, right? But I'm talking about digital gardening. What digital gardening is all about? Digital gardening is taking care of your assets, your mobile, your devices, cleaning them, ensuring that they run efficiently. What happens if you're using a device for a long time? Let's say a 1 year, 1.5 year, your battery dies out. Yes? And what we do, we run for another battery and ensure that it is there and we are able to reuse it. So that is good because that's a sustainable solution. But what happens? I've seen a lot of mobile phones. Every year, every month, there are companies that launch mobile phone. It's a new phone. I'm using X version, Y version, and there is a Z version. Immediately, I feel something is missing, right? I need to capture this. I need a new version, a new phone, a new spec, a better camera. I do, right? And I buy it. All right, you have the money. Go ahead, buy it. But what do you do about the device that was purchased a year back or 6 months back? Do we do or we always wait? Somebody will buy it. I will be able to sell this at a good price. We are not able to do that. And it stays right in our cupboard, right? And we do forget that e-waste is number one waste that we are generating every year. So we have to find, and these devices, the keyboards, the monitors, the mobile phones, they have some materials which are niche materials that can be reused to redevelop, recycle to brand new phone. That's a better solution. Then, you know, when COVID arrived, everybody was focused on, you know, staying at home, taking virtual meetings. Everybody did at that time. But what's happening is, as soon as the COVID is finished, everybody wants to go to meet people. The salespeople from the industry talk about, it's very important for me to meet this decision maker. I need to travel. I need to take a flight to Bangalore. I need to take a flight to Hyderabad. It's very important for people to be present in the class. But that is a sustainable idea? It's not. You can definitely do virtual meetings. Their decisions can be made because we were able to take decisions even in the last 2 years, right? When the COVID was very proactive. Now let's talk, we were talking about mental health. So from technology perspective, during the COVID times, what is important when you are sick? It is important the presence of your people that are around you, right? The feeling of touch, right? The emotion that is there, it was not there at all, right? Nobody was able to touch you when you were sick. Some of the people were in ICUs. They were very sick. At that time, they were not able to experience that feeling that somebody is there with them. They're known. They're a person that who can help them to sustain this change that is there around us. So what I'm giving is a VR device. A VR device that can emote the touch, that can take you places. It's not important for you to take vacations like 6 vacations. There are a lot of people that say that 6 vacations in a year is possible. I think not. You can take a VR device. You can give the same emotional, same touch experience through a VR device. You can delve into anywhere you want to go. You want to go to Seychelles to enjoy a beach. You can do that through a VR device, right? You want to go, you love mountains, you love cool breeze. Man, my friend, there are a lot of places where you can go through a VR device. And it's a more sustainable solution. I'm not saying that don't take vacations. Vacation take, but also do some staycations. Stay at your home, VR a device, and take that for a long period of time. Then, you know, storage, you know, data, right? Again, I'm going to delve into this. Now, data is the new currency, right? We are talking about oil and everything. Now, data is the new oil, people are saying. And when you go to specs of the mobile phones, there is 128 GB to 56 GB, 512 GB, 1 terabyte, and always go for the device which has the maximum spec. It has a fastest processor that has the maximum storage space available to me. Is that the right phone for me? It's not. So always go for lower spec phone and look for a more sustainable solution. The sustainable solution is you are storing your data on cloud. That's the better one. Now, when I talk about data and I'm talking about storing everything on cloud, the cloud runs on data centers, right? And the data centers are not at all 100% sustainable. They create a lot of heat, right? So we have to identify ways that how heat can be stored
and it can be used in other industries as well. So I have people from different fields, different, you know, and we can delve into this area that, you know, how we can solve this question from a sustainability perspective. Now let's talk about other points, right? Now, you know, there are three P's when I talk about sustainability. We talk about people, we talk about planet, we talk about profit, the three P's of sustainability. I think from researchers, the people that research proactively, from academia, people from practice, a lot of professionals, and I want to talk about, you know, policymakers from the government and from other areas, that what is the fourth P that can be? And over the years, I've seen the fourth P can be pioneering. Now, what is pioneering? Pioneering is all about innovation, the technology, the engineering. Because as is technology is changing us, I think we should think about the fourth P, which is pioneering. You know, how innovation can be embraced in a better way so that people, planet, profit, and pioneering can thrive together. So that's the most important thing from a sustainability perspective. So that's all from me. Thank you so much.